Hey folks, welcome back. Chris Garlock here with Michael Redmond, Nine Don Professional. We are, this is our latest AlphaGo versus the world. And of course, all 60 games will be the basis for volume two of AlphaGo 2-0. Due out, if all things go according to plan, by the end of this year. So fingers crossed. Michael, I think we have a new player today. Is that correct?
A new player, Shin Jinseo. And he was born in 2000. He's a Korean player. And so that makes him one of the youngest players, I guess 16 at the time of this game, maybe going on to 17. And he's a two-time world champion. But that comes after playing AlphaGo. So at this point, he wasn't a world champion yet. He was on his way. The first... he won the Asian TV Cup. That was 2019, I think. So, and then the LG Cup the next year.
Mm-hmm.
So he's on the top of the world in 2020, right now. And he was getting there at the time of the game.
Oh, cool.
So let's take a look. It's a bit unusual. The opening in this game is a bit unusual. You see White has played, instead of playing the star point or the other 3-4 point, actually, this maybe I haven't seen this orientation, but I suspect that AlphaGo might be playing this Shimari anyway. This move sort of invites Black to play an approach move to that corner. So it's very natural that Black wants to play here, White gets to play here. So the idea might have been just to start an opening without those corner enclosures, but to have more approaches to the corners by sort of enticing Black to play that approach in the lower left. So Black plays another Kokari, and we get this move. This move has always been a bit confusing for Kuen players. We don't, because it loses so much. It's obvious that it loses potential. Like after Black slides here, the value of a move in the corner is reduced by the fact that Black has played that peep at e5, e15 in this case. So and also Black is losing potential to play, moves like this, for instance, later on in the game. Hitting this side is an option. And when Black plays this exchange, all of that is gone. So a human player sort of wants to have some
options.
Wants to know exactly what that peep is doing for Black on the upper side. And for instance, in this board position, it's not all that clear. And so I think myself and most human players would sort of hesitate to play this peep. Although it does get fairly good scores with computer programs. So maybe that's a reason why we would try it anyway. But we don't really understand this move. Bottom line is that we don't understand it. We understand how that sometimes it will make a difference. So like, for instance, if White plays something like in variations like this, for instance, just to give you, it's probably not a very valid example, but when something like this happens, you can see that Black is making a hanging connection there with that stone. So when Black is playing these super aggressive variations, sometimes it does actually work. So White plays here. This is a position where actually computer programs like White to invade the upper side. This is going to be it's a pattern I see a lot. Once White has played this jump here in this one space pincer from the 3-4 point opening, the Joseki here, White usually jumps once and then plays away. It's a pattern I see a lot in Lila Zero and sometimes in Karago. It's just kind of a pattern, and they like to play away after that when White still has options like the 3-3 attachment to make a living shape. And Black will, and this will just develop into a big fight. When Black plays on the right side like this, then White will be aiming at the attachment here to make a living shape eventually, hopefully. And, you know, the timing is complicated. If Black plays this way, now White's going to have a stronger attack on the upper side with pushes here being forcing. So White's going to try to attack that Black group on the upper side of the board. Or if black plays something like this, then everything is light in the area and white's just going to play away. And so white has, depending on how black reacts to this, white has various strategies, you might say. And it's, so you have to have a pretty deep understanding. You probably have to have some experience with this way of playing, just leaving these two stones. It's sort of scary, I think, but it's something worth practicing, because it is, in a way, it's a very efficient way to play, because playing moves from these stones is a bit heavy. White's not going to gain very much. This is the old joseki. This is the move that was very popular at the time. But I think it is maybe a bit too heavy, a bit too straightforward. And white plays here in the corner. This, again, is a pattern that was seen a lot at the time. Already, the game is slightly good for black. Like, the moment white played this move, as I was telling you, it was not the suggested move. At the moment black pushed on the fifth line there, black was at 56%. So 56% just means that black gains something like 2 or 3%, because black does start with a small advantage if the komi is 6.5 points. Now this move, I had not seen it before. So maybe it was a new move.
Okay.
And it indirectly stops white from doing stuff like this immediately, which is what Shin Jinseo did. So that's the bad news. This is preventing white from doing that, actually. And we're going to see the demonstration in the game. So white had to start with this. And this would be looking at playing here, which obviously is bad for black's shape, or playing on the side. So white has various moves to continue with this stone. And it's going to make a difference when white plays something like this next also. So this was the correct move, the suggested move. If black covers here, now white can capture these stones. We get into something like this. This is actually playable for black. Black does have that hane at A there, which can start. Let's show you the variation. Let's have white play some random move. Black can play here later, and it's going to be a ko in the corner. So black can make that ko in the corner with this move. So this is playable for black. Otherwise, white might just play this and take the one stone. But white does have, in this case, white does have the attack here. So this would have been better than the game. Otherwise, if black plays on this side, white does have that cut at A. This is relatively, this is an even game. This is an even result. In the game, white cut here. Now, this is a move that had been played a lot when black had played some different move with that push. But we're going to see how the pushing stone there is going to take part in this fight. So at this point, already it's pretty apparent that if white cuts here and extends, then black can push through and cut here. And this is where this stone, obviously, is making a difference. Without that stone, it would not work for black, mm-hmm. and black would be losing. Without that mark stone, black would lose the whole group here on the side. With that stone, obviously, white is just collapsing. So white can't do that. White has to back off at this point. And the fact that white played this exchange, a lot of bad moves for white. All of them were bad locally. The fact that white played that exchange and had to back off here, it was just a miscalculation caused by the fact that no one had ever played this move before. And I would assume he was sort of on autopilot. It was early in the game. It was a 30-second per move game. And he was maybe thinking of something, different things maybe, or the whole board plan that he had. And he seemed to overlook that problem, because when black plays here, it's already a very striking difference. Black is over 70% in winning percentage at this point.
Wow.
So that's about 15 points before komi. So now white played here, and it's just bad. It gets worse. At this point, black is 75% when black plays this extra move here. So white had to leave the upper side. White's group in the upper right corner is alive already. So white should just leave that area. And it makes sense. Like this whole area, it does seem to be a relatively unimportant area. White does have a potential attack against that black stone on the left. But in this game where black has this big area in the lower half of the board, it is conceivable that black could just sacrifice that group and never left it. It's a relatively small area. So just to look at the game variation here, this is already very, very difficult for white. And like, just one final candidate move, just to show you, it's what I was talking about in the previous game. The game move was like this, and I can sort of understand this move. White is looking at this move next, and also this move. So white has some follow-up moves. Of course, white is looking at jumping out into the center. And white has played on the fourth line with the idea that white does not want to give black too much space on top. And this just pushing here. And this is just going to get worse and worse. Like the, it's going to be a splitting attack. And eventually white will not be able to save that. Well, you know, with AlphaGo, white will be allowed to save it, but it's going to be bad anyway.
Right.
So just going back to that point, white's final mistake here. The suggested move, and like it looks good, but I would say really, you know, now what next? And what next is that eventually white's going to jump in at A, and it's another position where I would just say that, you know, the computer program might like this, but I would have a lot of trouble making it actually work. Jumping, it's black's move right now, so black's going to extend. Or black's going to play here, one of those two. So if black extends, I would find it hard to see how this is. I would be a bit scared. That's how I'll put it. I'd be a bit scared. But this is the kind of strategy that white has to take here. Obviously, the game is far in black's favor, so white probably has to do something drastic like this. But I would be doubtful as to how successful I would be playing this way.
It looks at the black influence and thickness, you know, over, you know, more than half the board is really impressive, right?
Right. It's just so much space there also that white does not really have the time to take the initiative in the upper left part of the board. And that's how it worked out in the game too.
Yeah, no surprise. Makes it look so easy. Such an easy game, right?
Yeah, it's very simple when AlphaGo does it.
I know.
Yeah.
Right. Well, thank you, Michael. And of course, thanks to all of you for watching. We should give out some sort of prizes for folks who have you know, watched all of the series. We'll have to go back and check through the comments and see who our frequent flyers are. But in any case, you know who you are, and hopefully you've been enjoying them as much as we have. And we will see you next game.